Thank you very, very much. Thank you. It is great to be back here in the great state of Iowa. I want to start by reminding us, this may be indeed the most important election of our lifetimes. Now, why do I say that? Well, let's start. You know, I want to start talking about what's at stake for our country even before I talk about this retention election. Let's talk about what's at stake for our country. There are so many reasons we need to make President Obama a one-term president. Now, you can certainly start. You can start with just a series of broken promises. There's one promise I would like the president to keep. You may remember he said he was going to turn this economy around in 3 years, or he'd be a one-term proposition. Let's make him keep that promise to the American people. I want to just describe you three promises he has made and broken to the people of Iowa, the people of America. Number one, let's start with those economic promises. Remember, his own administration said if we gave him that $800 billion stimulus bill, unemployment would be below 8%. It has now been above 8% for 43 straight record months. That means 23 million underemployed, unemployed Americans. Median family income has decreased $4,000 since he's taken office. Median household worth at a two-decade low. 30% of those with mortgages are underwater on their mortgages. Here in the state of Iowa, that means over 30,000 fewer Iowans with jobs when he took office. That means here in Iowa, the median household income down over $1,000 since President Obama took office. The list goes on and on and on, but the bottom line is his policies simply haven't worked. I have no doubt that he has done his best, but his best is not good enough for America. This is not as good as we can do as a country in terms of growing our economy and putting our people back to work. Our recent college graduates, 50% of them are underemployed or unemployed. But it's not just the economy. He made promises to cut the amount of money we were borrowing from other states. We cut that deficit in half by the end of his first term. Instead, we've borrowed over $1 trillion every year since he has become president. $16 trillion in accumulated debt. My little girl wore a button. She brought it home from school several months ago. It said, "Don't anybody tell the president what comes after a trillion." You know, it really is our children's and grandchildren's future that's at stake here. You may remember the president was actually, several weeks ago, he was telling the Europeans they need to get their house in order, right their ship, get their economy growing again, because it was going to help America. The German minister actually said to the president, actually said to America, before you start telling us what to do, maybe you need to get your own affairs in order. Because you know, as a percentage of GDP, as bad as things are in the Eurozone countries, their deficit is about 80% of their GDP. In America, our accumulated debt is now 100% of our GDP. You know things are bad when the Europeans are telling the Americans that you're borrowing and spending too much? That's like the town drunk telling you you've got a drinking problem. Things are pretty bad when the Europeans are telling us you've got a spending problem in America. So he hasn't kept his promises on the debt either. And third and finally, he made a lot of promises to us on our health care. He said if you like your health plan, you can keep it. Yet it turns out as many as 20 million Americans may lose their employer-provided health plan thanks to Obamacare. He said he was going to bend that cost curve down. Now the government says health care spending will grow 2 percentage points more in 2014 than it would have without Obamacare. He told us he was going to cut our premiums to $2,500, except now the government says premiums will actually go up about $2,500 since he's become president. He said he promised us that he was going to protect Medicare, except now the CMS, the government's own actuary, says over $700 billion in cuts to Medicare are neither realistic nor sustainable. And even after all that, you're still going to have 30 million individuals without insurance after the implementation of Obamacare. Promise after promise broken, whether it was the economy, whether it was borrowing, or whether it was Obamacare. But you know, those aren't the most important reasons that we make sure this is a one-term president. The most important reason is that you've got two widely different competing views at stake in this election. Under the president's vision, we have now spent 24% of our economy every year goes to the federal government. 24% of our GDP, our record post-World War II. You want to see the future that looks more and more like Europe. That looks more and more like Greece. You know, I've noticed something. Whenever this president stops reading the teleprompter, whenever he goes off script, it almost seems invariably he says something that he later regrets. And I think they must have a full-time staffer at the White House whose job it is to go out there and say, the president didn't really mean to say that. Remember several weeks ago he said, oh look, the private sector economy, they're doing fine. It's the public sector we have to worry about. And Aide said, no, he didn't really mean to say that. And then in Virginia, a few weeks later, he said, if you've got a business, you didn't build that. An aide came out and said, no, he didn't really mean that either. In 2011, three different times, three different speeches, he said this about the American people. He said, we were lazy, soft, and we lost our ambition. I don't know about you, it doesn't sound like the American people I know. I've got a message to the president. Mr. President, the American people aren't lazy, we're not soft, we've not lost our ambition. If he really believes that, it is time for him to lose his job. It is time for him to resign. You know, this didn't just start this year in 2011, 4 years ago when he was running to be president. Remember in California when he wasn't aware that somebody was recording him, he said this about the American people. He said, we were bitterly clinging to our guns and religion. You know, I'm governor of the great state of Louisiana. We call it sportsman's paradise. I've got news for the president. We are proud to cling to our guns and religion in the state of Louisiana. I think that was meant to be an insult, but maybe we're just not smart enough to understand that. And I reckon there are a lot of people in Iowa that agree with this as well. But you know, I really look at his perspective. To me, it reminds me so much of the Occupy Wall Street perspective. There is a different perspective that doesn't demonize those that have been successful, doesn't go after small business owners, that says, you know, in America, you're not entitled to equal outcomes. You're entitled to equal opportunity. And what makes America so great is the circumstances of your birth. Where you were born, your zip code, your race, your gender, they don't determine your outcomes as an adult. What makes this country great is that every generation inherits more opportunities from their parents than we were given by ours. We need to preserve that American dream for our children and grandchildren. And that's really what's at stake in this election. So the first message I've got for you is Iowa is a critical state yet again. It is important you vote. It is important that we make sure that this president's a one-term president. But you know, our values are at stake not only in this national election, but in this state election as well.